how to nominate an outstanding woman for the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. You can get the nomination form and its attendant informational sheet by going to www.cogreatwomen.org. But here are a few tips on how to put together a nomination that will ensure your nominees being selected probably on a first or second time through the nomination system. First of all, who can nominate? Anyone can nominate except a current board of directors member from the Hall of Fame or a current selection committee member. That means a family member, a friend, a co-worker, an employee, and for those people who aren't still alive, the historians or scholars are very good nominators. Some women who are nominated know they've been nominated. Others do not, so it's up to you whether or not you want to tell your inductee if she's alive. If she's dead, you can't tell her. It's up to you whether to tell your inductee whether you are nominating her. Make sure you've researched all the facts about the nominee and know that there are no glaring negatives about her that might reflect poorly on her character. At the end of the form, you must attest that your nominee is of exemplary character and worthy of being in the hall. So if there are any things in her background that are at least small objections, you should bring that out. There's a final investigation of all nominees for the historical accuracy of the nomination and to make sure that there are no skeletons in the closet that come up. So just know that your nomination will be read and make sure your facts are correct and that there are no skeletons that might affect her nomination. If you don't know the person that you're nominating, make sure you have the means to contact that person directly if she is chosen as an inductee, because we will have one weekend in which to inform you and the nominee of her selection. So make sure you have current contact information. Nominations will be judged on the basis of the information about the nominee and without any regard to who wrote the nomination or who may have made a recommendation behind it. The selection committee will judge on the basis of what's in the nomination. If there are important facts that you need us to know, you have to tell us. Don't assume that people know all the important facts about your nominee. If there are bad things, don't assume that we won't know them and that the final judging will not pick that up. If you find a discrepancy in historical documents about your nominee, state both findings that you have, but make sure you have corroborating information for the particular fact that you are espousing. Don't just take two possibilities and leave it to the judges to decide which is correct or which is not. Because if there's uncertainty, the judges won't advocate for your nominee. Okay, the qualifications for a woman to be nominated. She can be contemporary or historical. That means living or dead. She has to have significant ties to Colorado, and that means a different thing for each different person. For example, Golda Meir spent a relatively short period of time in Colorado, but it was here that she came to Zionism, which molded the rest of her life. So the ties to Colorado run the gamut from having lived here all her life to having spent a short but significant time period here in Colorado. It's the connection that is important. Make sure that the selection judges understand that connection. The nominee must have made significant and enduring contributions to her field of endeavor. Now, significant and enduring are the two key words, because you must remember this is a lifetime achievement award. 100 years from now, as people look back and at this particular nominee, they're going to want to know if that has lasted over time. Make sure that comes out in your nomination. Then the woman must have elevated the status of women. What did she do that had a positive effect on the way women are or were perceived? How did this change things for women going forward? We can't all be the first to do something, but each first has a second. And each person who contributes something new, makes a significant contribution. Make sure that's in your nomination. The woman must have helped open new frontiers for women and for society in general. What does that mean? How did opportunities increase for women because of her actions or her contributions? And finally, the woman must have inspired others by her example. This doesn't mean that you should send in letters from every child that a teacher taught saying, oh, she was the most wonderful teacher I ever had. If the woman weren't inspirational, you wouldn't be writing about her in the first place. So make sure that you understand, you describe the significant impact of her achievements locally, statewide, nationally, or in some cases internationally. That's the important thing, not just that she was inspirational. You're already proving that she's inspirational by having your nomination. There are 9 questions on the nomination form. The judges base their opinions on the answers to those questions, so make sure you have all of them answered correct as completely as possible. There are a few do's and don'ts. Don't attach letters of recommendation. We really don't have time to read 400 letters of recommendation for each outstanding candidate. And believe me, each woman who is nominated is outstanding in her own way. Remember, the judging is done on the basis of the nominee's accomplishment, not who is praising her. So if you have a statement from someone who you think is very important, put that statement into the question, the answer to the question that that statement covers. Attribute the statement to the person who said it, and then make sure that in the reference section, that person's name and contact information is in there. If you use any kind of an outside site, make sure you have a complete site to the outside information. Don't send a copy of every award that the person has ever received. It's wonderful to see it, but sometimes we have 4-inch wide nominations, and that's really difficult for us to keep carrying. So a list of the awards is perfectly sufficient. And the awards that are not self-nominated or someone in her staff didn't nominate her for are more important. Do tell the nominee's compelling story as economically as possible. The length of the nomination is not as important as the power of the story you're telling. These are outstanding women already, or you wouldn't be nominating them. Make sure you give us the story as compellingly as possible. Some of the best nominations have been 8 paragraphs long. Some are 4 inches wide. It all depends on the woman. But you can do it economically, succinctly, and make sure we understand the woman's story. Once the woman is inducted, her story will be told across the state by the Hall of Fame, in speakers' bureaus, in portrait exhibits, in every event that we can possibly bring the stories before the public. The Hall of Fame has an oral history project in which we record every story in the woman's own words. This is for the live ones, the dead ones, we still haven't figured out how to do that for. But these oral histories will be marketed to schools, universities, libraries, museums all across the state so that children to adults can see the stories of these inductees. So when you're making your nomination, make sure that the story is compelling so that the judges can look at it and just be amazed as soon as they read the paragraphs. Thank you for submitting a nomination. Nominate early, nominate often. Make sure your nomination is in our hands by August 26th. The nomination form, which looks like this, is on the website. You can pull it off as either a PDF format or a Word document. Complete it, send the 3 copies to the address that is at the end of the form, and make sure it's postmarked. It's in our hands by August 26th. The judging will be finished by November 1st, and the new inductees will be announced the first week of November for the induction event, which will be March 8th, 2012. Thank you for nominating Colorado's wonderful women.